So. What do I say? Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. It is 9:01 a.m. U.S. Pacific Standard Time here in Los Angeles. Wednesday, January 24th, A.D. 2024. And we're going to have a fun, you know, loosey-goosey Wednesday show, right? We will talk about, I would like to touch on crime, but I'm also going to talk about Ketanji Onyika Brown Jackson. Pardon the click. Huh? JLP. No, no way, Jose. Right. I keep the door open in here. You may have heard Jesse off mic if you're if you have good ears and have the earphones in. Sure.
It's too hot, so you want the door and the fan on?
Yeah, I want the door on and the fan door open and the fan on.
Get out of here.
Get out of here. This is not Joel Friday TV. You don't get to just barge in and interrupt. Oh, sorry, Joel. Joel Friday TV. Yeah, Brown Jackson. Brown is her maiden name. Jackson is her married name. She married a man who is her biggest fan. And so I'm going to show you guys a year and a half old news report. Town and country news report about her. I censored the kiss. But actually, I did have an uncensored version of it. Ugh. But I'm not sure if I want to show it. So, we'll see. All that and your calls, guys, if you'd like to call in. I will get to you. Some of you guys are sometimes on hold for some time, and I appreciate it. But anyway, guys, let's get right on with the show!
1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, it's the Hake Report. The Hake Report. La, la, la. Oh, it's the Hake Report. The Hake Report. La, la, la.
Hey, guys!
Oh, it's the Hake Report. The Hake Report.
So, how you guys doing? I'm fine. This is purportedly, I guess, Joan of Arc t-shirt. It's my brown t-shirt. It does not say womanhood. Some of my Facebook crew. Is the Facebook crew in here? Hey, I got some Twitch people watching. And of course, YouTube and DLive, shout out you guys. Esoteric 07, lowercase o, number seven, is a sign for salute, people. Those of you who don't know, shout out to the boomers. Salute, sir. It fits a little tight. It's supposedly a medium. Maybe I'm just getting too big. But sometimes medium does fit a bit tightly. Wovenhand is a band. It's not womanhood. Wovenhand. It's that one guy whom I've played 16 horsepower guy. I'm blanking on that guy's name. But he became a band, or he started this project called Wovenhand. Christian. They're Christian. Nice. Even though he does at times cuss. You know those southerners, those country people, they cuss and they're still Christian. Okay? Maybe there's a time for it. But don't, I disavow it for the sake of the kids. For the sake of the children. I think brown is a good color. I love brown. I'm down with the brown. Okay. I would like to get to a call here, guys. I did not get to him yesterday. Joe in Phoenix, Arizona is on the line. Joe, thank you for calling and holding. What's up?
Good morning, James.
Good morning.
Wow. Potential good news for you.
What's...
My sources are telling me in the two capital cases against Trump that they're starting to be real concerned now that Trump's delay tactics are going to push the trials back far enough that he may have the election before convictions could come down. So,
right on. Potential good news for me. Is that not good news for you, too?
No, I like to see criminals prosecuted.
Oh, so your assumption is that Trump is a criminal?
He's already been proven so. There's already been a summary judgment in New York. He is a criminal, yes. That is a fact now.
A summary judgment in New York? Was that a criminal case?
The criminal case, yes.
Or was it a civil case?
No, the civil case, there's been no summary judgment. Well, there's been a judgment for Eugene Carroll, but the fraud case, there's already been summary judgment on that one. And that
the fraud case is a civil case. It's a lawsuit.
No, it is not.
Isn't it a lawsuit?
No,
isn't the fraud... You're talking about... Wait, which fraud case? You're talking about the one about...
Which fraud case, exactly.
Yeah, so which fraud case? You're talking about the civil lawsuit?
No, no.
Because I know you're relatively smart, so... And I know that you're not a trusted source. I know that. You've said stuff that proves not to
that,
be true.
Huh?
But you say when you say stuff regarding the law, generally you are technically correct because the law has nothing to do with justice, as you've told me. And you, too, have nothing to do with justice. But are you talking about the one where he supposedly inflated the value of Mar-a-Lago? Is that the fraud one that you're talking about? Or are you talking about the fraud with regard to, like, the elections?
Not the porn star stuff.
I'm not talking about the porn star stuff. I'm talking about the, I didn't even bring that one up. I'm talking about either the elections or the,
Letitia James is not civil.
Letitia James? Yeah, it is. Isn't it civil?
No, it isn't.
Oh.
That is.
Are you sure?
That is fraud. That is criminal, yes.
Are you sure? Are you positive? I thought if it's criminal, then how come it's just a matter of, like, banning him from doing business in New York and...
James, his CEO already did six months in prison on that, related to that case.
But the CEO may have a criminal case, but that doesn't mean the case against Trump and his organization and his children is criminal.
It is.
How come it's only a matter of fines I don't think jail is on the table with that case.
No, it is.
Jail is on the table with that case?
Yep.
I can't really trust you, man.
Wait and see, James.
A lawyer claiming guilty before being proven innocent, says Raymond Levin.
It wasn't a lawyer. It was a judge who pronounced that, not a lawyer.
No, we're talking about you being a lawyer, declaring him guilty. Aren't you a lawyer?
Not anymore, but I was for many years, yes.
Yeah. This is partly why he's like this. You were so you used to be an independent thinker, and then you went to lawyer school.
Okay.
I don't know if you were ever an independent thinker.
That's okay. That's okay, James. But anyway.
So you think that he's going to go to jail? How come I've never heard that Letitia James is a civil fraud case, says, or at least that's what John Frederick thought.
That's okay.
You're saying that's okay. You're saying that's okay that he's mistaken, or what? What do you mean?
I'm saying there's more to come out, and you will see. But
no, wait. You made a claim that this case is criminal, and we're thinking that it's civil.
There are many things that you don't know about yet, James, but this could all be a moot point. Is the point of my call is that his delay tactics are, I'm starting to think, almost a little bit genius.
The state of New York, spoiler alert, says the state of New York calls it a civil fraud trial. Are you, maybe you're not as smart as I thought.
No, I'm much smarter than you could possibly ever know, James, but that's okay.
Well, I'm sure that you have some smartness in you. You are God. You are created by God. But I don't think you access your smartness. You are cut off from your smartness.
funny how I was right about Cosby. I was right about Alex Jones. I was right about...
You didn't predict Alex Jones.
I absolutely did. I told I told you he would be hit with a massive, massive fine that would lead to bankruptcy.
I could be mistaken, but I don't remember this. You may be right. But I can't trust a word he says. Why doesn't he just admit he's wrong and we can move on? Asks American Anchor Baby. Yeah, spoiler alert is telling me, and it's so, the state of New York calls it a civil fraud trial. You're like a woman who won't admit she's wrong, and it's leaving us confused. Hake is rude, says Jupiter.
You go right ahead.
Wait.
Get all your shafts in, James.
Huh?
Get all your shafts in, James.
I'm not giving my shots in. I'm legitimately baffled. Because it is actually a civil fraud trial. I'm mistaken. This particular case is not, jail is not on the table. It's just banned from doing business in New York and a big fine.
We'll see.
No, you're saying we'll see, but you, mm-hmm. This is crazy.
James, again, his CEO has already went to prison and you think there's going to be fines? Okay. Go ahead.
I'm not saying I'm saying the
Go
case.
Ahead.
The
think
case.
I think I'm crazy, James.
Is the case at hand criminal? Last question: is the case at hand civil or criminal? The one that we're talking about with the black female AG or whatever she is of New York.
There's
Democrat.
Both. There's elements of both. All I will say on that.
It's what?
There's elements of both. There is a civil part of it. There's also going to be a criminal part of it that you don't know about.
Going to be a criminal part of it. Going to be. Okay, why didn't you just say so at the beginning?
Well, because you won't let me talk, first of all.
That's not a... I think that's... You're making excuses.
Okay, we'll see. The CEO has already been in jail. So
we just saw you make an excuse.
Was the CEO in jail or not?
I don't know, probably.
Okay.
I guess. CEO, whatever that means.
The CEO of the Trump Organization has already been to prison.
We'll pray for him. Chin up, King. Many a man has been sent to prison on false charges. And this man gloatingly laughs as though blacks, too, have not been victims of false accusations, mostly by other blacks.
Well, not this... completely made up.
No, it's not made up. It's true. Anyway.
Mostly. Okay. You know, I was thinking about something you said last week about how you were trying to push my button saying that I get so much hate because I bring hate. And you know I don't bring any hate at all. The reason I'm hated by your show and in the chat and by some, not all, because there are some who like me, is because I'm everything that they fear, especially some particular of your callers. I'm an highly successful, intelligent, well-educated, articulate black man who's in control of his environment and has done all the right things. I don't drink. I don't smoke. I don't have any bad habits. And that's what they fear. They don't want to see that. They want to see black people, black men in particular, as ghetto, trash, drug users, abusers, all those things. I'm everything that they fear and they hate, and that's why I get hate, James.
You look at you. You know so much.
It's just a fact, and that's the.
That's
real
not
thing.
A fact. That's your what's. That's what you surmise.
No, but that's exactly what it is. Exactly what it is. In fact, that particular caller that I don't even like to mention.
Mm-hmm.
He says it almost every time.
Oh, you like to mention that?
No, I really don't.
Yeah, I mean, how come you just did?
I'm making a point of how he brings up that he's so fearful that the white people are going to be under attack and eradicated and all that nonsense.
Well, let me share with you that whites would love nothing more than for blacks to be sensible. Which you are not, I will add.
Sure.
You're not That's all your that opinion. Sensible
You're
that you
You're
that you think you are.
You're welcome to your opinion, James. It's just nonsense.
It's a fact.
The overall majority of black people are good, decent, hardworking people.
No, the majority of people are evil.
64% of black men are now in the middle class, not ghetto trash like you guys like to portray.
Middle class is a communist buzzword, and middle class people are evil.
How much do you make? I bet you're in the middle class. Are you calling yourself evil?
No. Just because I said, I'm not necessarily calling myself evil. You don't understand math. That's a mathematical term to say.
Yeah.
Because...
Instead of the guy who's completely clueless about anything historical.
Well, we're talking about math here, not history, okay? When you make a statement, okay, I'm looking at three mics here.
You still don't understand the 1.05%, do you?
There are two mics that are golden. One mic is gray.
54%.
I can say mics are golden. And that's a fact, because there are mics that are golden. It doesn't mean all mics are golden. I learned this in school, and it's also common sense to say mics are golden when all mics are not golden. So if I say the middle class is evil, it doesn't mean every single human being in the middle class is evil. It just means
James, words
very
have
often.
Meaning.
I know, and
words
you don't understand
meaning,
them.
James.
I know. So do so do general statements.
General statements. Then be more specific in your speech. That's what the law teaches you.
Nope. I don't have to be more specific
in your speech.
If I'm speaking generally, I don't have to speak specifically.
If I said all people named James are evil.
Right.
Then I said, well, James Hake is evil. That's a big difference.
Yeah, but how about if you just say people named James are evil? Boom! People named James.
That's what I just said. Boom.
People named James are evil doesn't mean all people named James are evil. You just lack common sense.
No, when you say most people named James are evil.
No, I didn't say most. I didn't say all. I just said people named James are evil. It means some are. It means some, a remarkable amount of them are. Just like a remarkable amount of mics are golden.
James, you really need to understand what proof and evidence mean, because it seems like you're clueless about that.
It seems like you don't even understand statements. You make assumptions.
Anyway. Well, someday you and I will find common ground. I still live in hope of that.
But, nice.
I tell you.
Right on.
Anyway, that's the point I'm going to make. I think you may be happy with Trump in the future here. He may keep the debate tactics up until the election.
I'm happy with Trump now.
I gave you the real reason for the hate that I get. So,
okay.
That's what's happening. Have a good day, James.
You too. Joe in Phoenix, Arizona. I know a cat named James, and he is totally evil. He stole my Zippo. What's up, Kick? Brother Sonny over on Kick. Speaking of crime, you know, we don't have justice in America. I will have you know. I watched this. I saw this headline over in my push notifications. I get push notifications from far left Yahoo News, and they shared this headline of this middle-aged white man, slightly heavyset, gray hair, stating that this man from upstate New York was convicted of murder. Murder. And this reminded me of the Jordan... I'm blanking on that Jordan guy's last name. Jordan, I'm blanking on his last name. His mother showed up at a Black Lives Matter DNC event for Hillary Clinton. Shaking my head. There was a white man who shot into his SUV, the SUV in which he sat, during loud music at a gas station. He asked them to pipe it down. They got into an altercation, and he fired in there to their SUV. Allegedly, he claimed to have thought that they had a gun. He thought he saw a gun, allegedly. There was no gun, apparently, according to reports. And he killed Jordan. I don't want to say the last name because I don't think I remember the last name. And so that was a white man, you know, may have had a hot temper. He had just come from a wedding, you know, visiting a wedding, attending a wedding with a girlfriend or a female. And he was in a bad mood and he shot into that SUV and he was convicted of murder and it became a Black Lives Matter hero. A Black Lives Matter. Jordan Davis, thank you, spoiler alert. Thank you, spoiler alert. So-called murder. And it may have been a murder, I don't know. I don't necessarily think that it's murder. But this guy, this other man, was convicted of this, of murder. A white man. For shooting his shotgun twice, once perhaps allegedly according to him by accident, at a caravan of cars that were coming up in rural upstate New York toward up his winding driveway. They found out they went to the wrong place. They were looking for a house party of all things. What are you doing going to a house party in rural upstate New York? I guess they have nothing else to do upstate New York. They should be praying in quiet. This 20-year-old woman died. She got hit in the neck from this, I guess, the second shot of this shotgun. He claimed that the gun malfunctioned and he did not mean to fire that second shot, that apparently it killed her. And this happened around that same time that old white man shot through the door and shot Jarl, whatever that boy's young man's name is or was. I forget whether he survived. Down in, like, Kansas City, Missouri, I think. It was another Black Lives Matter dumb thing, accusing whites of racism. No such thing. And so this guy, he gets, he's... The prosecuting lawyers, rather than just being fair, they accused him of shooting out of anger. He wanted to, he killed 20-year-old Kaylin Gillis. Kevin Monahan, age 66, found guilty for shooting, of murder, for shooting 20-year-old Kaylin Gillis. On a Saturday night last April, she and her friends pulled into his long, curving driveway near the Vermont border, trying to find another house for a party, right? Convicted of reckless endangerment and tampering with physical evidence. Maximum sentence of 25 years of life. He hasn't been sentenced yet. It was days after the shooting of 16-year-old Ralph Jarl in Kansas City. Jarl, who was black, or is black. Oh yeah, he was wounded by an 84-year-old white man after he went to the wrong door to pick up his younger brothers. But this Kaylin, K-A-Y-L-I-N, Gillis gal, group of friends traveling in a caravan, two cars and a motorcycle. Imagine that, motorcycle being all loud. A slew of cars. That could look kind of intimidating. And nowadays, you see caravans breaking into stores, home invading. I don't know if you've seen the caravans home invading, but there are people who've home invaded, ramshacked people's homes while they're home. Home invasion is when you're home. Burglary is when you're not necessarily home, I think. North of 40 miles north of Albany. 65 kilometers for the Europeans and foreigners, or the people who know. Monahan came out to his porch, fired twice from his shotgun, second shot hitting Gillis in the neck as she sat in the front passenger seat of an SUV driven by her boyfriend. So she died. Rest in peace, Kaylin Gillis. So the prosecution, I don't know how they would know this, but they made this claim, told jurors that Monahan was motivated by irrational rage toward trespassers. Trespassers. He acted out of anger, somebody said, Assistant District Attorney Christian Morris. Doesn't sound like a very Christian statement if he's just speculating about this man. You're supposed to be fair-minded even if you're trying to get a conviction. You should get a conviction based on truth, not on speculation. That's the only thing that can be inferred from shooting at people within 90 seconds of them being on his property. He grabbed his shotgun and intended to make them leave as fast as possible, and he didn't care if they were hurt or killed. So claims this Christian Morris guy. Seems like a not very Christian claim. Monahan took the stand on his own defense, saying he believed the house he shared with his wife was under siege by intruders. Is that a believable statement? Sounds like a believable statement to me. When he saw vehicles approach, he said he first fired a warning shot to scare the group away. Then he said he tripped over nails sticking up from the porch. Well, whose fault is that? You gotta upkeep your porches, young men. Or 66-year-old men. Tripped over sticking nails from the porch, lost his balance, and the shotgun struck the deck. Then he said that accidentally caused the gun to fire at the Ford Explorer carrying Gills. Ooh, Ford Explorer, ghetto mobile. No, I'm kidding. Half kidding. I didn't mean to shoot the second shot. The gun went off, so he claimed. And I don't know if I believe him either. I'm neither believe nor disbelieve, right? So rest in peace, Kalen Gillis. But this type of stuff happens. How are you going to convict him of murder if you don't know? You know what I mean? Jelly bean? Terrible. So that's from Yahoo News, far-left extremist Yahoo News. And they were sharing reporting from far-left extremist anti-Second Amendment AP, Associated Press. When white men defend their property, perhaps a little overzealously, you know? Don't know? They come down, the hard hand of the law comes down heavy on them. In contrast, I saw this report, this news report in local news yesterday, of this woman who got reefer madness, pot. She went crazy on pot, psychosis. Marijuana-induced psychosis, allegedly. And she stabbed this young man to death. I don't know if it was her boyfriend. I don't know if she was living with her boyfriend. Don't be living with your boyfriend or girlfriend, gals or guys. That's not right. It's not right. But she somehow got pot, and the pot turns you kooky, crazy, according to reporting, and she stabbed the guy to death, and then also stabbed herself a bit. A woman, purportedly white, might be white Hispanic, don't know. And what did she get? For this brutal, looks like a murder to me. It's not an excuse to be crazy, in my opinion. It's not an excuse. She got 2 years probation. And she killed the dude. Blame it on the weed, laughing face emoji. She was already crazy, says Big Mitch 909. Indeed. Most of us are. Reefer madness. It's real. Some of you guys say it's not. I don't know. Was she vaccinated? Yeah, this is partly why I say do not sleep with each other. Don't be having the S word out of wedlock. And be careful with whom you get into wedlock. Because you should not just willy-nilly get into wedlock with a person. You know? But probation. Is it because she's a woman? And then she has to do 100 hours community service preaching to kids about the dangers of marijuana-induced psychosis. It's ridiculous. A guy arguably seems reasonable doubt that this man was viciously careless about these 20-year-old's lives when he fired a warning shot and shot towards them. And Joe Biden said to do that, by the way. Fire a warning shot. I disavow warning shots. You're not supposed to do it, right? Are you not supposed... Is it true that you're not supposed to be firing a warning shot? You can brandish it, I suppose, if you're on your own property. I wouldn't advise even doing the warning shot. And be alert. Be alert. Take a breath. Be present. No matter how heated and scared and... busy. What's that thing that gets in you? It was on the tip of my tongue. What's that thing when you're like ready to fight or flight?
Adrenaline.
No matter how much the adrenaline. I don't know if that's even the feeling that it is. You know, when you just have this hotness and supposed alertness, wide eyed. When you have that adrenaline going. Be alert so you don't trip over nails and drop the gun and it goes off. Or don't be so heated that you don't care. But Biden literally said, buy a shotgun. And he said, fire two, not one, but two shots in the air. Blam, blam. Buy a shotgun. And he even did this to the camera. I kind of like Joe Biden for stuff like that. But I disavow it because you're not supposed to do that. He was vice president under this nerd giving gun use advice. But I'm giving fair advice, nerd or not. Be alert. Hot flashes. And whites, you're not going to get any slack. Men, older men, you're not going to get any slack. People in general, people on the side of right, independent thinkers. January 6ers, Charlottesville people, people who don't, or who aren't sufficiently liberal, and even the liberals, you aren't going to get slack in general if you are in, especially if you're in the right or somewhat reasonable. Don't phantom muzzle me, Hake, says Nada. You scared? Oh, I disavow that. Trigger warning. Isn't that so crazy, though? Injustice. There's a guy who punched an older man for saying the N-word. A black Hispanic punched a man for saying the N-word, and the man died. And I think the guy who killed him, it wasn't intentional death. He didn't intend to kill him, I don't think. I think he just meant to punch him out. But he died. You punch a guy, they could die. And I think he only got probation, too, if I'm not mistaken. Buy a shotgun, not an AR-15. That's right. AR-15s are awesome, but I think the AKs are better suited for those of us who don't upkeep our stuff. You know, shout out to the blacks and people who don't take care of their stuff. Maybe Hake. I'm not going to say it. So, you know, there's a whole lot of injustice in the world. The law is not for what's right, about what's right. These lawyers, liars, prosecutors, defense attorneys, judges, so-called judges, juries, brainwashed juries. It's terrible. Terrible. So, be cool. Mark in Los Angeles, California, is on the line. Mark, thank you for calling and holding, man. What's up?
Yeah, thanks for taking the call.
Yeah.
I wanted to congratulate you on catching the snake from Phoenix in a lie this morning when he claimed that the trial against Trump was criminal with the peekaboo James, the racist.
Letitia James, you call her peekaboo?
Oh, that's what Trump calls her.
Oh, does he? Nice.
Yeah. She's a nasty woman, if you ever saw. She's kind of like a female clown from Phoenix.
Wow.
You know, it would be him if he was a female.
Okay.
And that was good that you caught him in a lie. He claimed that it was criminal. And then at the end of the conversation, the coward said that it's going to be. I didn't catch your whole conversation with him. But did he bring up the lie about Obama cutting the regulations more than anybody, any other president? I don't know if you guys talked about that. Because I brought it up to you yesterday that Trump, in his speech Saturday night.
Oh, yeah. That's right. No, I didn't bring that up. And I forgot to corner him on that topic.
The other one, okay, that's two lies. The other thing I would be curious about, what's the name of the CEO that's supposed to be in, that did 6 months in prison? You didn't ask him. I was screaming through the phone, ask this SOB what the guy's name is. Do you know the CEO that he's talking about?
No, and I don't even know that it's an actual CEO. It might be COO or something. I don't know the name.
Well, he doesn't either because it didn't happen.
Trump's ex-Trump Organization CFO, Chief Financial Officer Alan Weisselberg, was released from jail in April of last year. He did go to jail, I guess. Alan, A-L-L-E-N, Weisselberg.
Okay, so he was Trump's CFO in regards to this civil case with Peekaboo?
Maybe, I don't know. The Manhattan DA could potentially want Weisselberg as a witness in their historic criminal case against Trump, which involves a scheme to suppress negative stories about the Republican during his 2016 presidential campaign, per reporting from far-left AP in April of last year.
Okay, so Trump, well, he said CEO. You're saying in the Letitia James fraud case, or, where he supposedly exaggerated the worth of his property. You're saying, and this clown from Phoenix is saying, that Weisselberg was involved directly in that civil case?
Not in that civil case necessarily. This was over his role in a supposed decade-long tax fraud scheme. So he was sentenced to 5 months in jail at Rikers, 75 years old, by the way.
I remember that, but that's not connected.
It's a different
to the civil
case. It's a different case. They were throwing everything at. They're going after Trump for everything. They're just anything that they think might stick. They're trying.
Well, that's what third world socialist Marxist commies do.
Banana Republic, huh?
Pardon me?
Banana Republic.
Oh, exactly. New York is, California is, Chicago,
yeah.
And who dominates? Who dominates in those cities? Let you answer that.
Demon rats, not Christians.
And not white Christians either.
Right, yep.
To me, some of the stories that you told just now about whites who defended their property or themselves,
yeah,
and were sent to prison, I think we should all acknowledge that the white man has a target on his back.
Yeah, and know that so you can... You're held to a higher and impossible and false standard. So know that and be able to protect yourself.
Well, the problem is the juries to a large degree. These big city juries are full of guys, you know, like that bozo from Phoenix. You get somebody, would you want him on your a criminal trial that you were the defendant? I wouldn't want a guy like him on.
I don't think so. In general, not.
He says he was a lawyer. Well, what happened? Was he disbarred? Why isn't he a lawyer? I'm not impressed with him. I know you give him a lot of time on your show, and it's your show, and I don't have any beef with that. But I mean, just have to sit there and listen to him lie, and with that arrogant laugh that he's got, it sounds like straight out of hell. Excuse my language, but it sounds like Satan laughing in hell. But it's your show, and you could let him on.
Yeah, don't let it bother you, man. You want to watch yourself if you're reacting, if you're inwardly bothered by somebody else.
Well, that he always mentions me.
Yeah, I know. Fine. He said, I don't like mentioning him. But you guys are in each other's heads, and that's not good.
The only time I react or mention him, and I never say his name, is when he mentions me. If he would never mention me, I would never mention him. But I'm not going to let him talk, about me without reacting.
Well, that means that he's controlling you in a sense.
Well, I guess, and vice versa.
Right. Really, you guys are controlling each other. You guys are not indifferent, because truly, he should have no effect on your inner world where you're upset.
I listen to your show, and I hear him,
right,
and I react. But he doesn't in any way control any. I mean, what has he succeeded in doing other than lying? He knows the audience can't stand him. You could read the comments. They know he's a fraud. They smell a rat when they hear one.
Interesting.
But enough said about him. But the problem is there's too many like him out there. They're trying to con the white man into thinking, look, I'm your brother. I'm half white, and I got a white wife. Well, then you're my enemy, buddy. You're no friend. You're no ally.
Yeah.
And I heard your conversation yesterday with Ronald from Ohio, or Ronnie, whatever.
That might have, about the War of 1812. And
right, and I still don't understand the connection. Was he trying to say, well, because I don't know about the War of 1812, that I shouldn't be believed about anything? Well, I mean, he could take an issue, I could take an issue, bring it up to him, that he wouldn't know anything about. I bring up the Civil War because it's directly related to what's going on in America today.
Right. It's much more recent history.
I don't know where he's coming from. You know, this War of 1812, what is that supposed to prove?
A lot of intellectuals, and he is an intellectual.
He's an intellectual?
I'm not saying that he's necessarily all that intelligent, although he does have some in there, but he's an intellectual in that he's rejecting stuff without really having a real open mind and pondering how it could be true. And he's accepting stuff that is not necessarily so because of all the world and the sources that feed him bad judgments about based on facts. So he is into he's sort of somewhat of a history buff. He likes history. And he knows that he claimed that the War of 1812 brought about the Industrial Revolution, you know, when wars kind of create the need for invention and industry and mass producing weapons and things like that. And so that gets carried over into the civilian world. So that's why I think that was the main reason why he thought that the War of 1812, and he also said that it was our last war with England. And after that, they became our allies.
Well, how's that connected to our, you and me?
Not in any way other than comparing one war, the effects of one war versus the effects of the other war.
To me, it was just a dodge. I mean, he didn't want to talk about the things we talked about
regarding
the Civil War, so he brings up something, about the War of 1812. It's a dodge.
I think maybe he was trying to show off his knowledge, too, but I could be wrong. I could be wrong, Ronnie in Ohio, but maybe you were just trying to show off your knowledge.
Yeah, is he one of those Israel Hebrews?
No. He's not a black... To my knowledge, he does not consider himself a black Hebrew Israelite. He's just a black man, a family man, who partly agrees with JLP and partly disagrees, and partly agrees with Hake and partly disagrees. Yeah.
Well, he's not he's not that bad, I guess. But I'm glad we got this 1812 issue settled, because it was kind of an irrelevant thing to bring up, but, I respond if someone wants to talk about stuff like that.
Nice.
Yeah. Anyway, you got a great show, and you do a public service, and you're exposing who the rats of our society are, and for that, I greatly appreciate you and your time.
Well, that's kind. That's kind, Mark in Los Angeles. Thank you, man. Take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Oh, man, he got me good. Hake is a little slow. A little slow. I don't like the click, FYI. That's what I'm reacting to. Bye-bye. Click. Let me check for any super chats that may have come in, guys. Over on Rumble, shout out to the Rumble people. Spoiler alert, mildew grew. That handyman. Old Saucy, howdy. Old Saucy. 555-555-565. Thank you for the lemon. Shout out to the people in the D-Live crew. Get it together, Hake. Clicks going north, says Strifecast over in the D-Live crew. I am live on Odyssey, O-D-Y-S-E-E, the lonely platform. YouTube, amen. Says 1812 is too early for the Industrial Revolution. Well, I may have, like, given up to the birth of the Industrial Revolution. And that was how some people say that the North beat the South, because the North was more industrialized a few to several decades later in the 1860s or something, with the so-called Civil War, the War of Northern Aggression, some people call it. Over on Streamlabs, we're all clear, I do believe. Buymeacoffee.com. Someone bought a coffee. How many times is Mark going to say, but it's your show, when he talks about Joe? We get it. He's subtly trying to get Hake to ban Joe, and there's no reason for that, says someone with a coffee. That's not necessarily the case, man. he's just voicing his complaint and acknowledging that, hey, you do as you want. I'm not trying to tell you what to do, but I would ban him. I don't think he's trying to tell me to ban him. And William sounds silly giving a shout out to Mark, a guy who wouldn't even want William living next door to him by his own admission. He's for separating by race, not values. That's not necessarily the case, someone with a coffee. You can't make this stuff up. You know, even the most racist so-called, although we know that there's no such thing, even the most quote-unquote racist people always have the good ones, the allies. If you're a liberal, you're a white ally. Or if you're a conservative or a sensible person, also known as so-called racist, then they have one of the good ones. Or a sensible black man, an honorable black man. You know, like, give me a break. The reason that they don't like the blacks is based on their character. Get it through your head! But thank you for your coffee, as always, man. I appreciate it. You do contribute to the conversation, regardless of what I perceive to be your senselessness. And I say that with no ill will. If that's possible in Hake's dark heart. Daniel in Texas is on the line. Daniel in Texas, thank you, man, for calling. What's up?
Hi, James. Thank you for having me.
Of course.
Now, when you get into the topic of history, I get all excited.
Nice. I understand. You are also a history buff of sorts.
Yes, I am. The topic of the War of 1812 and the importance of it and why the Civil War is typically seen as more important. The War of 1812 basically established the United States as the sole authority of what happens in the New World. The United States went to war against Britain, and a lot of it had to do with territorial disputes over not just in areas around Canada, but also in the sea. And it was kind of the United States biting off a little more than it could chew in establishing itself as an authority over what... So when you... In the New World, after the United States has established its independence, the big question is, well, who's going to have free reign of what goes on in the New World?
Yeah,
you know, Britain just lost its colony.
Excuse me.
And the United States is here. Well, now the United States is basically this offshoot of Britain that has an ability to lay claim to everything that goes on in the New World, to include Canada, which is also the property of Britain.
Yeah.
And they bit off a little bit more than they could chew. And it was essentially a there's a lot of confusion about who the victor is, because there's no real victor out of that war. It's a bad look on all sides.
Yeah.
Because what ends up happening with Britain is generally perceived as the victor of the war. But the reality is Britain loses its dominion over expansion into the New World, like the United States does.
Right.
In the future.
Wow.
So that's the significance to the United States of the War of 1812.
Wow, clear victor, but people think that people in general perceive Britain to be the victor. I did not know that.
Correct.
And they lost the dominion over the expansion into the New World. That is so interesting, man. And that is so true about bit off more than you could chew, because war in general is probably unnecessary if you are among civilized men, right? Among somewhat civilized men, you can make a deal, you can negotiate, as Trump talked about with the Civil War. What did you think about Trump saying, I would have tried to negotiate around the Civil War, meaning not have the Civil War and try to negotiate?
I can't wait for him to build that time machine so he can do that.
Do you think he could have done that? Do you think a man of peace and let's make a deal could have done something like that?
No, because we are taking what we know now, today, and running with it with what they knew at the time.
Right.
And the question is, when is war inevitable? At what point is this now a war? And the conclusion is not exactly cut and dry. There are many answers to that.
Yeah.
But the general accepted, amongst scholars on when the Civil War started was after the Confederates seized all the forts in their territory, after they succeeded and claimed all the federal forts, there was one federal fort that didn't relinquish to the Confederates, and that was Fort Sumter. And Fort Sumter was there was a long kind of standoff. Jefferson Davis, who's the president of the Confederacy at the time, was under tremendous pressure to do something to capture this fort. And the holdouts in the fort, they were surrounded by Confederates. And Lincoln sent an envoy and said, I'm only sending food, because nobody wants to be the first person to fire.
Right. It's disputed who fired the first shot, in fact, right?
What's that? Say again.
Isn't it disputed who fired the first shot?
It's generally accepted that the Confederates shelled Fort Sumter, and that was the first shot of the war.
Oh.
And the reason that happened was because Jefferson Davis was under tremendous political pressure by his Congress and by the Confederates in general to do something, to actively establish an independent Confederacy. He was under tremendous pressure to do that. Jefferson Davis is not a we'd have to kind of go into a little bio of him, but the reason he's selected as president of the Confederacy is because he was largely a sensible, moderate person of the slaveholding South that was kind of he's very well respected. He was a veteran of the Mexican-American War. He was he had won all sorts of accolades during that war. He was very he was very moderate on his positions. He wasn't very far left or far right within his political party. He was a very moderate person. So he was just kind of a no-brainer for that title.
This is Jefferson Davis whom you're talking about?
Yeah, the president of the Confederacy.
Nice. Okay.
He was elected into this position, and now he's faced with Fort Sumter. And Lincoln and Jefferson Davis, neither one of them want to be the ones to fire the first shot.
Right.
But Lincoln is trying to send he's trying to ease a what is a very tense situation, and Jefferson Davis is under tremendous political pressure.
Yeah,
and Lincoln sends a he sends a vessel with provisions, and he says, "I'm not sending any weapons into the fort. I'm just sending food for the Federals in the fort." And Jefferson Davis, who is under tremendous political pressure to not let the Federals push, you know, their claim any further, orders the shelling of Fort Sumter, and that is headed by General Beauregard.
Mm.
And but that's still not an inevitability of war. War is still not on the table. The war is generally acknowledged starting when Lincoln calls for volunteers. The fort is shelled, and Lincoln immediately calls for volunteers. The Federal Army at the time wasn't a very large army. It was a peacetime army.
Yeah.
So they only had 15,000 men in arms at the time, which is a very small number. Remember, I told you at the end of the Civil War, there were scores of thousands, there were 20s of thousands of Confederates still in arms at the surrender. Well, prior to the Civil War, there was only 15,000 Federal soldiers, to give you a scale of how massively things had ramped up during the war. So do you follow me on any of that?
Not really.
Okay. My point is, at the time it was a peacetime army, there wasn't really much that the Federals could do at the moment to prevent the Confederacy from forming these militias and sieging all of their assets in the South. And once that happens, the Federals now need volunteers. They need people.
Yeah.
They don't have people, right? So the war starts when they ask for help.
Okay.
We need you. That's when the war starts.
We must have been really divided to go to actual full-blown war, killing one another.
Yes, and that's why I say that the people who lived in the Union, the North, and the people who lived in the Confederate States in the South were not the same people. These are different people. They have different ways of life.
Yeah.
They have different ways of practicing their product. They're all Protestants. They have different ways of practicing their Protestantisms. The people who lived in the Union had this idea that a man owned his own labor, and with his own labor, he could use that to move to whatever position he actively pursued in life, and that was the general idea.
Okay.
And in the Confederacy, there was a God-given dominion of the slaveholders and their slaves.
Okay.
And that was the two different types of societies. These are not the same people. They don't see things the same way. They don't see things eye to eye. They don't like each other. They are, anyway, they go along to get along up until the Civil War, where these tensions have basically got to a point where there's no resolving these differences. And one of the catalysts for the tensions of the Civil War comes from previous wars and in particular, the Mexican-American War. And the Mexican-American War was not very popular. But what ends up happening after the Mexican-American War is the United States gives reparations to Mexico for damages, and Mexico cedes all of the land, you know, north of Mexico today. And that was the result of the Mexican-American War, and it was not a very popular war. People don't like wars.
Yeah.
They don't like sending their, you know, sons to go die for what they perceive to be of no benefit to them.
Makes sense.
And there were a number of people that that Grant at the time was he worked in supply during the Mexican-American War, and one of the reasons he was so proficient throughout the Civil War was because of his knowledge of supply routes. Grant also understood, and Lee was an engineer. He was in the Army Corps of Engineers during the Civil War. And
the Mexican-American War.
I'm sorry, the Mexican-American War. And he had all sorts of accolades. He was essentially the bravest soldier of the Mexican-American War, as cited by his superior.
And he was a Union soldier, although it probably wasn't called the Union at that point. It was called the these United States of America.
Yes. Oh, another thing I just want to touch on. You say so-called Civil War.
Uh-huh.
If you want to be a Confederate, it's okay if you say Civil War, because General Lee did pen that those actual words in letters to Jefferson Davis. He did say, "This our Civil War."
So although I love the beautiful South and the Confederates, I can still call it a Civil War.
You can call it a Civil War. Robert E. Lee called it a Civil War.
Okay.
If you want,
and I don't really want, I don't really necessarily want to full blown take sides, because I really don't know. It's irrelevant, honestly. But I want to just show love to the South and understanding, you know, right. And to the North too. I want to show love and understanding that, because there's just nothing but hatred and malice and dismissiveness toward the South as traitors and losers and racist and stupid stuff like that. And that's so evil, I think, today.
Right. And one of the things that I think it's important to convey is Southerners are not just, you know, they weren't just guys who just didn't know any better. Oh, I guess I just didn't know that this was a stronger power. That's not what's going on. What's going on is the Southerners really have, they have a very real probability of winning their independence.
I heard, you've told me they could have gone either way.
It could have gone either way up into, all the way through the end.
Yeah.
And a lot of people just, they look at wars, they go, oh, you know, well, this is where the tide of things turn and it's all over. You still have to fight the war.
Right.
It's not over.
I know.
It's over.
You
it's
gotta
over,
finish. Some people can't finish.
You gotta finish. You have to finish it.
And if you're playing basketball and you juke the guy, I know that juke is more a football term maybe, but you pass him up and then you miss the layup or you skunk the dunk. That's probably not the real thing. You mess up, then you're still a loser.
Or you come back from defeat. you come back from absolute defeat.
Right. Yep.
And this is why you have to look at things moving forward as opposed to taking what you know now and then looking backwards and then saying, oh, well, obviously after Gettysburg,
right,
things are just not going to work out for the South. That's not the way it works. That's not the way it works.
Man.
The way it works is you have to compel surrender from the person who consistently is gaining victories.
Say uncle! Say uncle!
Exactly. If that person doesn't say uncle...
Yeah, tap out! Tap out already!
It's not over. Then it's not...
Yeah, you're so right, man.
So,
interesting!
But,
you know,
and that's
man,
not just me. That's just not just me. That's a reality.
Yeah.
The Confederacy could have had its independence as late as the last months of 1864. After that, it starts to get real squirrely, but it's not impossible. Lee's still able to fight. He still has all of his army. They're getting battered. He doesn't have too many victories after that. He really doesn't have. He has one, essentially, major victory after Gettysburg. But still, it's not over until it's over. That Lee can still maneuver. He can still gain popularity amongst either internally or he's always had the morale of Southerners.
Daniel,
even after the surrender. So,
I appreciate it, man. It's been a great call. I gotta run. Okay. I'm past time. I am remiss in going over the hour. Call me again, man. It's good to hear from you.
Will do.
All right. Bye. We are past the top of the hour. It's time for some music. It's Work Hard Wednesday. Starflyer 59 is the epitome of working hard, if there is such a thing for musicians. Now, I know musicians work. And even rappers, they work too. Somewhat, of sorts, right? And this track is entitled, When I Learn to Sing. It's from the 2001 album Leave Here a Stranger, Starflyer 59, When I Learned to Sing, Ya Musical Philistines. You might somewhat enjoy it. It may get a little irritating with the repetitiveness of this one line, but it's cool. Hang tight. Be right back for the rest of hour two. Thank you guys for bearing with me through that, you know, kind of nice. Starflyer 59, When I Learned to Sing. Yes, folks, that's from the 2001 Christian album on Tooth and Nail, Leave Here a Stranger. It's Christian, guys. Good drummer. Sounds like early Coldplay or Snow Patrol. How about Coldplay and Snow Patrol sound like Starflyer 59? Hake likes underground music, says Brennan. Somebody said something. Some people said something. Yeah, we were sowing scenes of the California beach called San Onofre, California, down near San Clemente, or in San Clemente area, down by the Marine Corps base, Camp Pendleton, I think is what it's called. This is pretty good, Hake. Not the worst thing Hake has played, but meh, says Nada. Thank you, Lauren. You know, kind of nice. It's a banger, says Nick. Dang, that was on tooth and nail. Nice. Yes, indeed. Hake low-key loves Under Oath. I've never knowingly that I can recall listened to Under Oath, maybe in person at Cornerstone Music Festival. I used to go to Cornerstone Music Festival in the early 2000s, way over in the area of Peoria, Illinois, Bushnell, Illinois. I would fly into Chicago, Chi-Town, that one very famous airport, and then I would walk to Union Station. Homeless bums would ask me for money. Sometimes I actually gave it to them. Oh, no, don't give homeless bums the money. Actually, I'm not sure that they were homeless, but I just suspect. I gave the one guy the money, I think, 2 years in a row. He gave me the same sob story 2 years in a row. What a sucker. Hake, what a mess. He was black. Darn, missed the Hake music, said Obvious Globe. I think San Onofre is mentioned by the Beach Boys. I could be wrong. Yeah, O'Hare, Chicago O'Hare. O-H-O apostrophe H-A-R-E. No I believe. And I saw Sears Tower. Very nice. Very nice. Christian music festival. Not very Christian, actually. Under Oath. Oh, I gotta get to Ketanji. Ketanji Onyika Brown Jackson. They don't actually do. They do. I don't know what you guys do. Do any of you guys listen to the Hake Report? You guys who do the clicks? Shout out to the Africans. Africans do clicks. It doesn't mean every African does clicks. It just means there are Africans who do clicks. Learn English. So Ketanji Onyika Brown Jackson. Brown is her maiden name. For some reason, she kept it. Is she a southerner? Her children should get that name. I have a whole bunch of pictures from here. We're looking at the headline that says, everything to know. What's to know? Apparently, Hake thinks it's to know because Hake is sharing it about this gal, Dr. Patrick Jackson, husband of judge. Now she's so-called justice, a judge, a black female liberal judge. Isn't a judge supposed to have good judgment, first of all? Who is Ketanji Onyika Brown Jackson? She went to this white school, Harvard, I think. I call it a white school. It's a school, right? And she saw somebody flying the rebel flag, and she led this whole campaign protest thing to get people to take down the beautiful rebel Confederate Southern beautiful flag. And she bragged about it, and the mainstream media brags about it. It's in her Wikipedia page. I don't know if she bragged about it, but she shamelessly did that. Did she ever repent for that? For hating the beautiful South and accusing it of racism? Just for flying the beautiful rebel flag? Just because the South had slavery? The slavery's not racist. Slavery was a good thing. I mean, it was just, it had its benefits. I don't know if it was good or bad. I can't. It was a moral and political evil, said General Robert E. Lee. So maybe it was, I don't know. I'm not going to fall all over myself pretending that it was, that it's something that blacks have any business taking umbrage about it. I think we need to drop our umbrage. Umbrage? Just like we, the Christians, should not be personally bothered by the sight of that vulgar LGBT flag. We should not be inwardly bothered by it. We can see it's these people are blind for flying the ugly rainbow flag, but not be personally bothered by it. Or And yes, it is an attack on Christians. It's part of an attack on Christians, and it's an attack, really, truly, it's an attack on themselves. They're hurting themselves, the LGBT. So a rebel flag, I happen to know that there are a lot of people who take it wrong. So I'm not going to necessarily fly it everywhere. But I know that many people mean it right. They mean well with it. But this woman has no sense like that. She has no sense of freedom and decency toward people with whom you disagree over the rebel flag, the beautiful Southern flag. So that's strike one, Ketanji Onyika. Onyika was her middle name, right? Nobody knows. So now she's in the so-called Supreme Court thanks to evil, I was about to say Obama, which is to say Biden, who said he would nominate a black woman for the so-called Supreme Court. What a joke. And she was a judge before this. So during her opening statement, according to Town and Country, it's a woman outlet, to the Senate Judiciary Committee. This is from September 2022, okay? Old news. Jackson, meaning Ketanji Onyika, said of her husband, "He's been the best husband, father, and friend I could ever imagine." This is a report from Emily Burak. Her husband is joining the Supportive Spouse Club. I didn't know there was a club like that. It's not capitalized, so it's not a real club. And look at this. Embarrassing. Look at him. He's old. He's sitting next to her with his leg crossed, one leg crossed over the other. It's old school. It's not necessarily effeminate to be crossing one leg over the other. It's old school. Although it doesn't look like the manliest thing in the world, but Biden does it. Old men do it. I've seen old men do it. And they're not necessarily full-blown effeminate. But in this case, this guy is somewhat effeminate. You know, when you hold one knee, swing one knee over the other and cross your legs like that? When you're sitting down on a chair? Trying to describe it for the podcast listeners. And then he has one hand outstretched over the forearm of Ketanji Onyika. Did you know that that's a couple? That's a married couple. Doesn't it look a little odd? Slightly strange? Supportive Spouse Club. Where is my spittoon? Embarrassing! During his wife's confirmation hearing, the Senate approved her. Shameful Senate. They don't approve anybody based, but they'll approve this extremist, anti-white extremist, anti-man extremist. Dr. Patrick Jackson, March 2022, could be spotted sitting behind his wife, crying tears of joy. Look at this! Number two, screenshot two, Ketanji husband two, wept. And this is terrible. Cover your eyes and ears, faint of heart people who overreact to vulgarity. Irene Carmone, a writer for NY Mag, KBJ, Ketanji Brown Jackson. Her husband has wept through the entire hearing, and it is a screenshot from C-SPAN, U.S. Supreme Court confirmation, and he's kind of has a furrowed brow and his arms crossed and he's crying. Terrible! Even more terrible? I can't even say this guy's name without wanting to spit. Chastin Glesman Buttigieg. At Chastin on X wrote barfingly, "Don't say that word, kids." Apologies to the ladies, the mothers of kids who might be tempted to say the B word, arf bay, because of Hake's bad example. We love a supportive spouse. Welcome to the club, Dr. Jackson. Oh, so this guy pretends like he's quote-unquote married Chasten Boot Edge Edge is quote unquote married to Pete Boot Edge Edge, the South Bend mayor of Indiana. How embarrassing, South Bend. Why did you vote for that feller? You gotta be lost, Indiana. This guy pretends he's married to another man. That makes no sense. That's silliness and worse, perhaps. Kids, don't fall for it. Do not fall for it. So he's crying. And you can see the gal next to him, the young lady. That's his daughter. Can you believe it? Can you see the resemblance? She's a little bit light-skinned. She's black. Part black. Light-skinned black. Mixed with him. This Jackson. Terrible. I'll show you more pictures of him. Of her. Wait, zoom in on that face. Is there any resemblance? She's not even crying. Why would a child cry? A young lady cry at her mother getting a job? Getting another job. A so-called upgrade. Look, she's like fine. Her husband, her dad is beta crying. Terrible. I look more related to him than his daughter. His own daughter. I could be wrong. Maybe there's a different. No. They look like they might have a little bit of relation. Mixed kids. Shout out to the mixed kids. Okay, what else is happening here? The couple met when they were both attending Harvard. Oh, so he married an edumamificated woman. Ketanji. What kind of American name is that? That's the name of a gal who... Onyika. Is she like an anchor baby from Africans or something? Because that's not a normal... Ketanji doesn't necessarily sound African, though, is it? I don't know. I forget. I've looked into it before. But Onyika means something. I forget what it is. So she had no chance but to be a hater of the beautiful South, really, because her parents might have brainwashed her. I mean, they gave her that name, Ketanji Onyika. Ketanji Onyika. Look at them walking through the hall like they're so important. He's actually, they married in 1996. She finished law school in Harvard. He graduated from Columbia University's medical school. The college sweethearts married. They now have two daughters, Talia, 21, and Layla, 17. So another picture of the daughters. Well, one daughter particularly. One is wearing a mask. I don't know who that is. That might be. Look at the girl. So he is now a gastrointestinal surgeon. Ooh, good for you, man. So he has a strong stomach, just not a strong constitution not to cry because his wife's becoming a Supreme Court justice. Ugh. He's related to Paul Ryan through marriage. Patrick's brother William is married. Patrick Jackson's brother William is married to Dana Little Jackson, Jana Ryan's sister. Jana Ryan is the wife of politician Paul Ryan. I'm jumped over to 6A over there. Hassan. After the news of Ketanji Onyika's nomination, Paul Ryan, the rhino Irish male, because he's not an Irish man, Paul Ryan posted on X, at Speaker Ryan, posted, Jana and I, Jana, his wife. What is his middle name? Is his middle name Ron DeSantis? Paul Ron DeSantis Ryan, including his wife? Jana and I are incredibly happy for Ketanji and her entire family. I mean, it's his wife's somewhat in-law, Patrick's husband. I mean, wife. Incredibly happy for Ketanji and her entire family. Listen to this. Our politics may differ, but my praise for Ketanji's intellect, At least he called her Ketanji. For her character and for her integrity is unequivocal. The woman who said, I'm not a doctor, I'm not a doctor, I won't define woman. What a woman is. Even though she well knows this high integrity, high character, high intellect, Ketanji Onyika, well knows that going through the courts to this day, and possibly all the way up to the so-called Supreme Court, is mumbo-jumbo LGBT, non-binary, transgender, fake things, cases, going through the courts. Am I wrong? Or am I wrong? Or am I right? She well knows that what is a woman is relevant to the courts because they're pushing this nonsense as though it is sense. So there goes her integrity, Paul Ryan. And she has no character. She's a woman trying to play with a 17-year-old daughter trying to play judge and justice. That's not Paul Ryan. You're an Irish male, not a man. There are Irish men. Kiss up. And by the way, going to part B, he turned off replies. Yeah, replies were turned off. Only accounts Speaker Ryan mentioned can reply. And to whom did he mention? Nobody. He knows that he's going to catch some hate. He wanted to ban the hate. There might be people who get more likes than him or who distract from his well wishes. Well, that's his right, I guess. Replies turned off. What a beta. And this part is where it gets really disgusting. Really, really disgusting, guys. Spent 15 minutes on this. Okay, Patrick and his wife. Patrick is his wife Ketanji's biggest fan. Ugh! That doesn't look right to me. But hey, I've seen the black clapping. Yeah, I did that on purpose. I've seen white men and black women get together, and I respect the white man, and I respect the black gal. Even though it doesn't look right to me, you do you, I guess. But I do understand the miscegenation laws somewhat. I do definitely understand that because they had to do the segregation thing back in the day. And how are you going to segregate these mixed people? And, she's just not attractive. Sorry, says Shane. I'm not going to comment. I can't even say mildly. But, hey. But look at him. He's kissing her head. Maybe I should have censored this, but show this censored one. They're actually full-blown kissing on the lips and hugging somewhat. Their arms aren't all the way around each other. Maybe not as thin as they used to be. Hey, we all have a fat problem in America. Maybe not all, but many. All doesn't literally always mean all. And so I censored, the hand on her, small of her back. And the censorship over the face. I'm not sure. Okay, cover your eyes just in case Hassan decides to show the uncensored version. Because I don't think that we should be taking pictures of these things, necessarily. To me, especially when they're not the most attractive couple. To me, it just doesn't look right. Oh, thank you. Town and country, it must be a woman's outlet. Ugh. Oh no, an actual kiss, says Clovera. Whoopi and what's his name? Yeah, sort of looks like Whoopi Goldberg. So that was written by Emily Baruch. How come I'm sweating? Emily Burak, she, her, is the senior news editor for Town and Country. I've heard of Town and Country. She covers entertainment, culture, the royals, and a range of other subjects. Before joining TNC, she was the deputy managing editor of Hey Alma, a Jewish culture site. Not Christian, necessarily. Some Jewish people are Christians. Jesus, hey, I think. And don't harass her, but she is EMBURACK on X and IG. Whew. Remember what JLP said about PDAs, y'all? It's game over for them, says Court over in the chat. Thank you, Court. Good reminder. Woof. Thank you, Hassan. I know I gave you a ton of super chats there. David in Ocala, Florida, on the line. What's up, David in Ocala? How you doing?
Hey.
Hey.
I saw what you're talking about. I wanted to just call real quick for like a minute.
Okay, right on.
Can you believe, I mean, they let two dudes get married and adopt a kid?
Yeah. That's not right.
That's just so messed up, man. Uh-huh. And then that guy that married Mrs. Brown, we'll just call her that. I mean, that just looks weak. She's probably all he could get, you know, so he figured, hey, I better marry her.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what it looks like to me, anyway. I mean,
yeah,
you know, he don't look like
I don't know, man. That's
he don't look like a power dog. You know what I'm saying? He don't look like somebody that's, you know.
Yeah, he looks kind of beta.
Down his door.
He is one of those smart and capable guys. If he were your gastrointestinal surgeon, you would respect him, I bet. But you're right. He does have that beta look, and they do have that beta look together. It's mm-hmm. That's so worldly of you to say, oh, that's all he looks like he's all she could get.
I know. I just, you know, so.
You're but, so worldly. You know,
the president, you know, said he was only going to consider a black African woman for that position.
A black African woman?
A black African American woman for that position on the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
And if that ain't prejudiced, I don't know what is.
It is. It's prejudiced.
You know? And then she couldn't even tell you what a woman is? I mean, how far have we fallen?
She could, but she didn't want to. I don't know if she could. Right. I don't even know if she could. She refused to.
She could. She didn't want to answer the question.
Yep.
You know? Because they're all into that diversity, equity, inclusion thing. I mean, that's another reason why I would call. I mean, they're just slinging it right in your face, right?
That's why I want to call out my my intellectual caller, Ronnie from Ohio, saying, oh, she's not a doctor. I think Ronnie from Ohio said that on the Jesse Lee Peterson show when Jesse Lee said she couldn't even say what a woman is. Because he was saying, well, it's not her job or whatever. But it might well be her job because it's relevant. This stuff is on the big stage. Right or wrong, it's on the big stage. Whether the Republicans are right or wrong for making this big deal out of the transgenders or if they are signal boosting it. You know, because when you fight against something, you're accepting it. And the Republicans are overreacting, fighting in the wrong way. And
well, we're losing ground, man. These people are, you know, I mean, with the colleges and everything like that, they've just taken over. I mean, I'm almost to the point now where I'm like sort of ready to give up. I mean, I hate to say it because I just feel like we've gone too far.
There's a right way to give up, though. It might be the answer to give up, you know, like because what effect are you really doing with your mind? You haven't given up, right? What good have you done?
Well, it's probably because of my age, you know, too, but it's like, you know, the immigration thing. I mean, there's got to be some big plan here. I mean, you don't let 25,000 Chinese men in here, you know. I mean, they were given statistics on the news today where they started realizing, I mean, they're letting like all different nationalities, you know, and they sort of keep tracking the numbers a little bit. And supposedly I think it was in New Hampshire, I'm not sure, but anyway, around the country, these Chinese people are coming in here and growing illegal pot farms.
Really?
Okay. Uh-huh.
Shameful.
Yeah, which I mean, I'm just saying, you know, that's what happens when you let people just walk in. I'm not saying anything about the pot thing, but
right.
You know, they're going for, they're trying to make money.
Yeah, you know what? They say, illegally. Oh, you know what? They say that, Asians are better law abiders than whites. That is not true. That is not true. And I'll tell you why I say that. They tend to vote Democrat more often than whites. They come from communist countries. They have a communist mindset. They do not have the spirit of the freedom of speech, necessarily, most of them. They believe in the racism thing and are brainwashed into hating whites on some level. And they come from these cultures where they're shysters. They shyst each other. There's low trust society, even if it is all the same, say China. China's communist country, and it's all practically all Chinese people. All basically the same race, more or less. And there's distrust.
Yeah, they're really hard.
There's a whole lot of distrust amongst each other because they shyster each other. They don't give refunds if something is defective. There's people claim something is defective on each other, and it's not. They do these scams on each other and other people. They are very tight-fisted with their, and I point to my elbow, like the Mexicans do, with their muy codo. They're really tight-fisted with their money. They're worse than the Jewish people, or maybe just as bad.
Try to sell them a car. I mean, it's unbelievable.
They're not honest the way that whites are honest, is what I'm trying to say. They're not, they don't like trust one another to be Christian and high integrity.
Yeah, I used to just walk up and point to the price of the car, and let's say it'd be $25,000, okay?
Yeah.
Years ago. Anyway, I'd point to the price and I'd say, I'd just ask them, what do you think you could buy this car for? And they'd go, I give you 17 right now. I'd say, see you later. Just get out of here, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah, you're right. They're rough, but
yep.
Anyway, real quick about the Civil War, man. I'm not going to go into the war, but my grandmother had a house that was built in 1835, okay, in Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay.
And a soldier walked right into the house with a horse, you know, a long time, way before she had it, okay?
Oh, okay.
And put a horse hoof print right in the wood, okay? Anyway, my cousin and I used to go out and find all kinds of belt buckles and all kinds of Civil War stuff out in the woods.
Wow.
Yeah, it was really cool. A lot of granite rocks. There was a woman that was buried on her property, a slave woman.
Okay.
And she was buried in granite rock, okay? And you had to walk past this grave to get up in the woods. And, man, we would be scared to death coming in and out of them woods, going past that gravesite at, like, 6 years old. I mean, the fear that would come on us.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah, we still talk about it to this day, man. I mean, it was just any time. You know how you are when you're a kid, you know? I mean, it wouldn't bother me now. But,
right.
You know, the date that was on this lady's grave was, like, 1863.
Wow. That's awesome.
Yeah.
That is wild. Who was this in your house? Who was the, I mean, I'm not saying asking you to dox what relation. It was an aunt or a great aunt?
No, it was my grandmother. It was my grandmother on my father's side.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. And so he.
What state was that? Did you say? What state?
Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay.
He had a real well, like a well like Hansel and Gretel, where you drop a bucket down. That's how old this property was.
That's
where you
awesome.
Drop a bucket down and pull water up, but they put a faucet on the side of it, and it the best water I ever tasted in my life. I mean, the tea was just incredible. And somebody is right, that wine that I'll let you go, that wine that I told you about is called cake bread, not cake spread, okay?
Oh, cake so bread, not cake spread.
Yes, yeah, I saw you wrote cake spread.
Okay, that's funny.
Yeah, but it's cake bread.
Okay.
I put an S in it, like cake spread.
Right.
And spoiler alert, you know, he's on top of his stuff.
Uh-huh.
I'm sure it was him that fixed it. So, listen, have a great day, man, but think about that diversity, equity, and inclusion train is running, man.
Yeah.
It's running wild.
Yeah, it is. That's what that is. It's, thank you, David.
Yeah, have a great day, buddy.
All right, you too. Bye. I hung up before getting a click. Hake has a very exaggerated sense of what doxing is. He says, come on, man. I know, we use the term dox very loosely, very loosely. Some of these ladies and men in the chat dox their gender. Don't dox your gender. And birthplace. I was born in America. I was born in... What? Don't be saying that. Do not be provoked into self-doxing. Be slick, ladies. Rick in Hampton, Virginia is on the line. Rick, thank you for calling, man. What's up?
James, what is going on, my brother?
Just hanging out. I'm in my rage room. Somebody said, oh, Hake is going into his padded rage room. This is my padded rage room. That's a JLP.
Wow.
That's a JLP show reference.
Rage room. There's somebody get raised when blacks come over here and act like victims and stuff. You know, I notice when I see a lot of blacks and hear a lot of blacks, they act like blacks haven't done nothing in the world, that they are so innocent people. And the truth of the matter is, James, everybody has dirt. I mean, no one has clean hands. Nobody.
Yeah. True.
Nobody has clean hands. You know what I mean? Blacks had slaves before civilization started it.
Yep.
Africa still, most of Africa still has slaves today, and I think they should hold sanctions on Africa, if you would ask me.
And that's why I say we should talk about hatred, because rather than this phony idea of racism, because racism is only selectively used against whites, by and large.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
Hatred is something that everyone is guilty of. No one is clean. No one is sinless.
Racism is nothing but hatred, just like Jesse be saying.
Yep.
That's all it is. They just give it a word, keep blacks angry, but it can continue to use them for destruction.
Yep. So true,
and
man.
Pretty much all they do is just keep blacks angry. It's like if they see a few blacks waking up, all of a sudden they'll say, what is it, white supremacy, racism,
yeah.
And get blacks back into that rage.
Indeed.
And they control them, you know?
So true.
And it's the way it is. And
some things will never change.
It's sad. We gotta wake up, man. And sometimes I don't think if we don't wake up spiritually, get over our anger, you know, get over our anger, it's over.
Yeah.
That's a fact.
Yeah. We really do.
Okay.
Because that's what leads to war and destruction. And war is...
Yeah.
Only going to be, it leads to all these unpredictable evils. And, you know, there's some good things that result from anything. But no, you're right. We got to get past. I encourage you, the listener, or you, the person with ears to hear, heed the warnings of the wise. To get past the anger. Nice.
Get past the anger, man, because if you don't get past the anger, man, it's like God can't communicate with you, because when you're angry, you can't hear from God. You want to do what makes you feel good, from being impatient, judgmental.
Yeah.
You know, can't see yourself. You can see everybody else's flaws but yourself.
Yep.
And you cannot bear the fruit of God. You can't have good relationships.
Yeah,
and that's what most people when it comes to dating most black women, they still have their trauma that they never get help for, and they dealing with it, and they think going around shouting and screaming up in church is gonna solve it. But once you harboring that anger, you ain't getting nowhere.
Yeah, so true.
And that's true. You know, you getting nowhere. Like you're spinning wheels in mud.
Indeed. It's terrible. And you try to make your relationships work, and you're just all distracted on stuff that doesn't even mean anything.
Right.
Wasting your life.
You hear black women say, y'all just can't deal with a strong black woman. No, it's not that. You're right. We can't deal with an argumentative one.
Right. Yeah.
You know, and out the dating scenes, most black women are the least desired women to date.
I've seen reports about that and commentary on that, where it's with these so-called dating apps, they say that the Asian women are the most commonly sought after, and the black ladies, and the poor black ladies are the least.
They down last. The last.
But you should be off those dating apps anyway, ladies and gentlemen.
You know, and the thing too, and you're right. As a matter of fact, what Joel was talking about that the other day, should you meet somebody online, and he was saying, don't do it because, you know, just like, I'd rather meet you in person because online, anybody can paint a picture.
Right.
You know?
Definitely.
And I want to see you in person, how you react to certain questions, you know?
I totally agree, man. Rick, it's great to hear from you, man.
Great to hear from you, James. Love you guys. I'm trying to support all y'all shows, man.
Cool.
You know, when I have the time, man, and y'all doing a great job, man. Like, just y'all continue putting the truth out. Oh, another thing, too, man. What's going on with gold investment? I heard a recession coming.
Oh.
Everybody's saying grab some gold and silver coins. I mean,
might be good advice. I couldn't say. I'm gonna have to rush you off the phone though, Rick. I have to keep it moving. We're coming to a close, and I feel the inner pressure.
Okay, good. I'll hit y'all tomorrow.
That sounds good, man.
The Joy Out Friday show. Love y'all. Y'all be blessed.
You too, man. Appreciate it. Bye. Rick in Hampton, Virginia. Let's talk about gold tomorrow. I don't know anything about gold, but I have heard a lot of people say, mostly a decade or so ago, but might be worth it. Darian, a first-time caller in Georgia, I have a short bit of time with you, man. Thanks for calling. Am I pronouncing your name correctly?
Yes, Darian.
Okay, what's up?
Man, quick question, bro. Like, what's going on? Like, I'm not too familiar, but what's going on in the Middle East? Because I've seen you poke around. You've got a lot of information in a lot of different areas. And I'm just flabbergasted on what's going on in terms of Ukraine and whatnot like that. Can you expound on your opinions on that and everything like that? What side is what? Blah, 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 blah.
Okay, so I have a feeling that the Ukraine versus Russia is evil versus evil. And
ooh.
I have a feeling that this Israel-Palestine thing might also be evil versus evil, although I do kind of like Bibi Netanyahu, but I don't know the man.
Benjamin Netanyahu, he's I'm on air quotes here, president of Israel, right?
Not quite the president, the prime minister, but yeah, he's a leader. He's one of the top leaders, if not the top leader in Israel right now.
Okay. Now, in your opinion, I know you're short on time, but let me briefly get an update real quick.
Cool.
In your opinion, I know everything's evil versus evil in terms of, as JLP says, it's a spiritual battle.
Uh-huh.
However, in terms of earthly matters right now, like what's going on, like which one's categorically, air quotes, worse in terms of the two different wars that are going on right now in our state of affairs?
Okay, so those two wars, they're both, in my opinion, kind of bad. I say we should stay out of both of them. We shouldn't really be aiding Israel in that war. I don't think they need our help. And we shouldn't be helping Russia or Ukraine. We should let Ukraine fall and let Russia take it over.
All right.
I honestly think so. Yeah, go ahead.
Quick follow-up question. I'm trying to nail these out. Which one, in your opinion, do you believe is the closest, in terms of the factions that are fighting against each other, is the closest to coming to God, which is a self-realization of one's own spirit? Which one is closer to self-realizing that, hey, you know what, this is messed up. We need to stop this. We need to find another way. Because I know Trump, if he was in office right now, he would be more spiritually close, air quotes, close.
Yeah, Trump would be one who would be negotiating peace. I don't know if any single one of those countries is. I'm not familiar enough with any one of those countries to say which one would be closer, or so-called countries, which one would be closer to God, or closer to repentance or whatever. I can only surmise that there would be individuals from all four some of whom may wake up. I can only surmise that.
Last question, promise.
All right.
Out of the Democrats and Republicans that are here today in office, we got a lot of weak Republicans. We have a lot of deceiving wolf in sheep clothing Democrats.
Yeah,
we're kind of as a country, I believe, in my perspective, and stuck in between a rock and a hard place. Air quotes.
Yeah,
and so you know the Democrats hit us last time with vote for the lesser of two evils, blah, 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 blah. I don't necessarily, well, two evils is two evils. There's not one good or worse. You know, they're the same, right? So which party right now, currently, in your opinion, do you believe is the closest to repentance?
That's a good question. I think both parties are far from repentance. Both of them are hopped up on ego, judging the other party. And so I know that in name, in stated principles, although they don't follow the principles, Republicans are say they believe in God more, whereas Democrats have kind of wanted to reject God. But the people who say they believe in God, there's a big difference between saying you believe and not actually believing. So I think there will be individuals who wake up in both parties and stop believing in those parties.
So we have RINOs, which is Republican in name only, which I believe to you have just described. What would that same name be for Democrats? Can Democrats even be...
No, they're just full-blown evil. They're all full-blown. Darian, I got to run, man. Call me again if you can.
Thank you.
Take care,
man. Thank you.
All right. Bye. Guys, this has been the Hake Report. Let me read any last supers. I know that there was one from Based Nation who says, which is worse, Hake whining about the click or hearing the actual click? Fair point. That's not a point. No, that's a question. And there are a couple of more coffees that I'm going to have to get to tomorrow because I got to end. It's Volmar Wednesday, guys. Joel Friday is coming up next. This track is from Volmar, William Go Away. It's the 2004, I think, album, 13 or so people who need chances. William Go Away by Volmar. Adios, America. Bye.
It was the other day she saw him standing there, looking in the mirror, looking backwards to the room. William, do you think we'll ever get to run away? Not just in a car, but by a boat or by a plane. You work an honest day, but William, it don't pay.
William, go away. What a nice vibe.
In the mirror, everything is calm and cool. Life is just a picture, and a wife is just a fool. Honey, don't you know that I don't care to run away? Plenty here to offer if we live the honest way. Oh, honey, don't complain. You see, it's all so clear.
So nice. I gotta get out of here for Joel Friday.
William, go away. I don't want you no more.
So sad.
What I want is something new. You're really a bore. William, don't you stay. I don't need you no more. You are such a hopeless fool. Just walk out that door.